A fool declares his own righteousness, right? Amen. But a good man, who can find? Right? And a good man, who can find his righteousness? He's not going out and talking about all his righteousness, but a fool is running around talking about everything that he's doing and everything that he's doing right. Okay? Let me say this to you, that when we have a problem with personal piety, and this in a sense is pride, okay? We get our eyes on ourselves. Right?
Amen.
Doesn't even Jesus Christ talk about that the Pharisees went about to establish their own righteousness? Oh, there are so many Christians out there who are trying to establish their own righteousness. Okay? I'm going to do this, and I'm going to be good, and I'm going to be good here, and I'm going to be good there, and I'm going to be good over here. It's not your righteousness.
No.
It's imputed righteousness. It's Christ living through you.
Amen.
Right? Not by works, lest any man should boast. See what I mean?
Amen.
So we look at other people. We start to look at their faults. And trust me, there are plenty of people out there with many, many faults.
Amen.
And oftentimes when we start to look at other people's faults, it's because we're feeling bad about ourselves. And what needs to happen? Well, in order to build ourselves up, we need to tear other people down. You see what I mean? In order to be the tallest building in the city, you've got to take all the other buildings down. Okay? Let me tell you something. That's not the way God works. Okay? You do not need to tear other people down to make yourself feel good. Okay? Why don't we just build each other up? See what I mean? So there are three things that we focus on when we lose our focus. Number one, other people. Are your thoughts on what other people are doing? Well, let me say this. Simply put, they shouldn't be. They shouldn't be. Your thoughts need to be on what you're doing, and my thoughts need to be on what I'm doing, not what everybody else is doing. And how they're doing it and how they're doing it wrong. And I'm not at all saying that we shouldn't exhort one another and we shouldn't help one another and we shouldn't judge each other in certain contexts. But the overriding theme of our thoughts should not be on other people. It should be on ourselves. Okay? And it should not be on our current problems. I'm sure that in here this morning there are a host of problems that are represented in this church. Financial problems, family problems, work problems, all kinds of things across the board. Okay? Don't focus on your problems. Focus on God. Amen? Focus on God. And lastly, don't focus on what you're doing right. Okay? Don't focus on what you're doing right.
Amen?
Amen? Your personal piety, how good you are, how many people you win, how much you read your Bible, how much you pray. Listen, you don't need to talk about that.
Amen.
You don't need to discuss that stuff. Amen?
Because
I'll tell you something. Your words don't need to be said at all when it comes to that. Your actions will definitely show people that those things are prominent in your life if they are, not your words. Okay? So don't focus on other people, don't focus on your problems, and don't focus on your own goodness.
Amen.
When we do that, these are all evidences that somewhere along the line, we're losing focus. Somewhere along the line, we are not focusing on Jesus Christ anymore. We are focusing on somebody else. Okay? And let me say this, and I've said this many times, hurting people hurt. If you are a hurting, injured individual here today, like many of us represented here, I know a guy who once told me, well, I'm a Christian, I don't need to go to church. Okay? Church is for Christians.
Amen.
It's like a big hospital where we all come and get treated for our problems. Okay? And so what happens? We're all hurting. We're all injured in here. And we have to be careful with that because hurting people hurt. And that means that you have to be careful of other people who are hurting because, look, they want to lash out sometimes. And that also means you have to watch yourself. That sometimes if you're hurting, you have to be careful that you're not lashing out at other people. It goes both ways, see, in this whole thing. So don't focus on other people. Don't focus on current problems. And don't focus on your own personal piety. If that is your focus, okay, then chances are you're not looking at the Lord. You're not considering Him. You're not meditating on Him. He is not the focal point of your life. Now what happens though when this takes place? What do we lose when this happens? When we begin to concern ourselves with any one of these that I mentioned, and just about every problem that takes our attention off of Jesus Christ falls into one of the three categories that I just gave you. But when we begin to concern ourselves with any one of these, our attention is taken away from the Lord, and we lose sight of things. Can I give you four things this morning that we lose sight of when we are out of focus? You with me?
Yeah.
Four things that we lose when we are out of focus. Number one, obviously, as you read here, divine fellowship. We go to Luke chapter 10 with me this morning. In Luke chapter 10, and I'd like to show this to you. How many are with me this
Amen.
Morning?
Amen.
Okay. Luke chapter 10. And look at verse number 38. Luke chapter 10, verse number 38. I'm sure many of you are familiar with this story. Okay? And it says in verse number 38, "Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word." So you have two ladies in this house. Do you get the story here? You have Martha and Mary. The Bible specifically tells us that Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet, right? Listening to Jesus' every word, hanging on Jesus' every word. And it says in verse number 40, "But Martha was cumbered about with much serving." Sounds like a victim, doesn't she? "And came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister have left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she might help me." Oh, she is a victim. She's a victim of her sister. Her sister who wouldn't help her work. You see? What happens? Well, in verse number 41, "Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things." Jesus Christ knew what was going on in her life. Amen?
Amen.
"But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her." You see that? Let me just point this out to you. That in this particular instance, in God's Word, we see a perfect representation of all of the three reasons that we just talked about in one woman.
Amen.
Right? I guess it doesn't have to be an either or. Right? It doesn't have to be other people or current problems or personal piety. It might be other people and problems and personal piety. Do you see that represented in this story here? Let me walk you through this, first of all, as we look at Mary. Mary is our first focus here this morning. Mary, or Martha, excuse me. In verse number 40, look at what she says. "But Martha was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me alone to serve, Bid her, therefore, that she help me." And Jesus answered and said unto her, "Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things." Number one, look at what it is. My sister. Do you see that in verse number 40? My sister. What's she focused on? "But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone?" What happened? What's she doing? She's saying, "Look at my sister. My sister left me. My sister did this to me. My sister did bad things. Look at what she's not working. My sister's not working." What is it? Other people. Other people. Here's Mary, and she's looking at Martha saying, "Are you crazy? We've got the Lord right before us. Let's listen to what he says. Let's sit at his feet. Let's hang on every word. Let's have divine fellowship with him."
Amen.
You know, we don't need to worry about the dishes. We can do dishes anytime. We got Jesus with us now. Let's focus on him. Let's look at him. But Martha was too busy looking at her sister. Well, what's my sister doing? What's my sister not doing? What's my sister doing wrong? First sign that we've lost our focus. First sign that we're out of focus. You with me?
Yes.
Okay? And what did it cost her? It cost her divine fellowship. Did she get the dishes done? Well, probably. But she didn't get to spend personal time face to face at the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
Now I'll tell you what. I'm a perfectionist and I like an organized house and I know I'm crazy.